Hey everybody, welcome. Joy and I are grateful to see you. I don't know what's happening here, Michael.
There should be a little X right there. Let's hit that.
Well, I don't know how to get rid of this.
You just ended the live.
Sorry, guys.
Check that and see if it shows up on the screen there. Refresh your screen. We're still learning this. You know, it's a whole learning process for us as well.
Please be patient.
But while she's trying to look at that, if you might have noticed, we've had to change our format for today. We were going to be doing rescue, but our rescue team had to go out on a late rescue. So we ended up having to switch to another topic for tonight because they weren't prepared to come in.
It's on
a delay there. So we're going to end up talking about housing tonight and what you need for housing for your bunny. Trying to get some things that are, you know, good for them, spacious for them, reasons why. So we're going to talk about, you know, a lot of that this evening. Okay, so first thing that I want to talk about is actually the size of the house, type of house, you know, that you've got. And think about the size of your bunny, okay? So really, you know, the standard rule of thumb, and I'm gonna kind of show this right here, is 4 times the size of the bunny. And that is really the minimum size that you would want to have, okay? Then we wanna make sure that there's enough room for that bunny to completely stretch out, stand up tall, okay? So these are things, so we want to make sure that the bunny can completely do a natural motion for it. So think about yourself, and we're going to put you in a closet that is only 4 feet wide and 4 feet tall, maybe only 2 feet deep. You can't stretch out, you can't lay down, you can't stand up. All of those things, you know, are very important for you, but why would we do that to a bunny? So it can't do any of those things, right? So we wanna make sure that it has all the things that it needs and can still stretch out tall or stretch out long. And of course, you know, when that little bunny wants to stretch out, we're talking about front legs forward, back legs straight out, so that little bunny can become that long. And of course, again, standing up so that we have, you know, the head or the ears do not bump when it comes to the size of the cage, okay? And a lot of the things that you end up seeing, you know, at the pet store, you know, are just absolutely, you know, horrendous. So we're going to talk about actually some comfortable housing first. And one of the things I may have mentioned earlier, you know, in a previous broadcast, with COVID and everything going on, and of course, as soon as Bobbie and I leave, you know, we have our masks, you know, as soon as we leave this area, that we're familiar with, you know, being quarantined. And if you would have to be quarantined and say you want to make sure that your family doesn't catch it because you've been exposed and now you have to stay, you know, away from the family, you're in your bedroom for say, you know, 2 weeks, I can pretty much guarantee you that you want to have a comfortable bed. You want to have maybe the TV, maybe a laptop. You certainly want your smartphone, so you'll be texting and phone calling. You want your earbuds. You might want your e-reader, you know, all of these things, you know, even a book, you know. But the point is, if you're a kid, you want your video games and all, you know, being able to chat with your friends, all of those kinds of things. So, but we want this to be comfortable. And one of the things we tell people, you know, bunny really should have at least 4 hours of exercise out of its cage every day. So what is the opposite of that? 20 hours a day stuck in the cage, okay? So if that animal does need to be in his cage that many hours out of every day, that animal also needs to be able to be comfortable, okay? So really, when I talked about the, you know, size of the bunny and 4 times, the very smallest thing we really recommend anymore is a 48-inch two-door dog crate, okay? So that dog crate, and we do a two-door simply because all dog crates open up from the far end. But trying to take care of that bunny means like launching yourself into that cage, you know, trying as the bunny runs to the far back. And we want to make sure that, you know, from the side, from, you know, we can actually reach everything. So again, here's a two-door, you know, you can reach right in there. It's a big door. So now that bunny can see my hand coming in, not coming right here, where it's, you know, bleeding on this little door. And, you know, it can see, I can scoop up the bunny. I can, you know, do things with it, reach around, get its food, it's, you know, clean its cage, all of these things so that it is, you know, a nice, comfortable setup for it. So again, you know, going to that photo, and I'm gonna show this again. All right, so we have a nice hiding box for that bunny. We have a food bowl, water bowl. We have chew toys, a place for the bunny to hide, you know, the hay rack, litter box. All of those things are all contained in there so that bunny can at least be comfortable while that bunny has to be confined to the cage. So another thing that ends up being really, really good is a exercise pen, okay? And it really disturbs me that they call them exercise pens because it's really 4x4 and there's no way anything can exercise in there, but they can move around a little bit better in there. So now there's a little bit more room for a larger bunny, and actually little bunnies probably need more room than even big bunnies because they can be very hyper, bounce off the walls, that type of thing. So they need a lot of room to run around in. But here again, we have a nice, you know, where the bunnies can hide. They have their food bowl, water bowl, their play toys, their chew toys, you know, and all of this, and they can still move around very comfortably. So if you've got a bonded pair, a big bunny, or a little bunny that needs lots and lots of, you know, space to move around in, those exercise pens work really, really well. And usually they are actually less expensive than the stupid little cages that they have, you know, for some of the bunnies. So again, and I'm gonna have Michael, if you would actually take the camera, we're gonna actually show a couple of cages. Yeah, it should be able to be just unclip it for the moment. And there we go. All right, so right here, we're going to go to this cage first, all right? So, a little typical standard wire cage. You probably have to get it down a little bit lower there. So, now, take a look at the size of this cage. It's only, you know, about 20 or 22 inches wide here. And would you put your little dog or your cat in this cage? Bring it around and actually, right, show the whole cage here. Okay, there's my Monty Python bunny, because that's usually what happens when you've got an animal in there. So it's got this wire floor, which is designed to let the poop and pee fall down there. But I can guarantee you, say, oh, well, it's smooth. Okay, do that and keep doing it and keep doing it and find out just how long it takes before it is now abrading your hand or think about your feet. And bunnies do not have any paw pads. Dogs and cats have, you know, heavy callus paw pads, and we wouldn't put them in that cage. Rabbits have no paw pads. All they have is skin underneath that fur. And so being on these floors causes sore hocks. It causes abscesses. We have had bunnies come in here with sores open to the bone from being on wire floors. And you've got this little tiny door, so you can get back down again. All right. So you're trying to reach in for that bunny, okay? And again, you know, if this were a dog, would you make that dog live in this space? And notice there's nothing in here right now. So there's no food, no water. As soon as you start putting things in there, you've just taken up more space. And, you know, you've just got this little door. So for that bunny, when you put them in there, it's kind of like putting them in their tunnel down in those warrens, only there's no back door, no escape route. And when you reach in, that bunny, you know, feels trapped and cornered. And you trigger a fight or flight reflex. They cannot flee. Well, yes, but they can attack. And that's exactly what happens, you know, with them. So, you know, and then if you're trying to get that bunny out of there, okay, think about it. Your arms are trapped here, but, oh, I got you. I'm trying to pull you out. And what does that bunny feel like? Well, I've been captured by a predator. I'm being pulled out of my tunnel. I'm going to be killed and eaten. And they go ballistic on you, okay? So, you know, and I said, had one lady ask me one time, she goes, but my cage opens up from the top. Great, now you're hawk. You've got to think like a bunny, okay? Not, you know, like a human. And so, you know, they give you a tray, which, you know, it's like now the rabbit is living over its toilet. It is constantly breathing the fumes underneath of it. So it can just cause all kinds of health issues. So again, you know, if you would not put your little dog or your cat in this cage and make it live there, why on earth would you make your bunny live there, okay? Then the next thing that you find is this one up here, which has my little sad-eyed bunny in it. You probably have to lift it up here a little bit so you can see here. So my little sad-eyed bunny, which, you know, may fit perfectly on little Susie's dresser, except, you know, it's being ignored, okay? And this poor thing, do you think this bunny can exercise, move around? There's nothing in there. They are extremely intelligent. They get really bored. They get depressed. There's nothing for this bunny to do. Nothing. Nothing mentally to occupy it. Nothing physically to occupy it. And you've even got an even tinier little door to try to deal with, you know, going in there. And all prey animals, whether it's a chicken, duck, cow, horse, they have their eyes here on the sides of their head. So they can see, you know, predators coming. So now you come right here where they're blind. Okay. And like I said, you trigger that fight or flight reflex. Yep, you're trying to get that out of this little tiny door. And again, if you wouldn't make your dog or your cat, and say, or even a chihuahua, how big is a chihuahua? Maybe 3-4 pounds. Average bunny, maybe 6-7 pounds. If you wouldn't do that to your little dog, why on earth are you doing it to a bunny? Okay, they need to be comfortable. So I'm gonna move down to a little bit, you know, because I mentioned the dog crate. The unfortunate thing about, you know, the dog crates is that when you go into the pet store to look, usually this is the size that's on display. This is a 36-inch dog crate, and it is a nice side opener, but I have placed in here an ordinary cat litter box, just your normal size cat litter box, okay? Back up, how much room is left over? Now, let's just say I put a bowl of water and a bowl of food in there. How much room is left over? By the time you get finished, that bunny is backed up into a corner. This is not enough space for a bunny to be comfortable. So again, that 48-inch dog crate is really, you know, the minimum size that I would really recommend for anybody to use. And then there's all of the things that go along with making that bunny comfortable while you're away, okay? So we can go back over here. And I mentioned places for, like, the bunny to hide. So I'm gonna walk here, okay. And this one right here, nice sturdy cardboard box. Yeah, I'm gonna have to come down for it. It's tilted down. Okay, so back up just a little bit here so we can actually get to see the size of the box. There we go. All right, so, and I've got this just nice sturdy cardboard box. It is sturdy enough for the bunny to sit on top of, hide inside, dig on it, chew on it, and when it's messy, you get another cardboard box. You know, now it does have to have at least 2 openings, all right? So I've got one here, there's actually one here, there's one here, okay. So we're a little bit limited with the camera space here right now. And that bunny, because down in those tunnels, okay, they have multiple exits out of those tunnels. So we want to have that for the bunny too, because they consider one door a trap. So this guinea pig igloo, one door, one way in, one way out, it's a trap. Guinea pig might love it. Bunny, not so much, okay? Not to mention it's kind of plastic we really don't want them chewing on. Now, the other things to take into consideration here, this box here, and you might have to get a little bit closer, has a really shiny finish. So things like magazine paper or this, you know, type of thing, that shiny finish, the shine comes from clay. So that would be really bad for them to be chewing on. So you don't want to get anything with a shiny surface. Back down to this box, ink is not an issue. It's all soy-based because of children. You know, we don't have lead-based inks. So it's not a problem. So as long as you've got this matte finish and then a nice just box on the inside. So there are times when you can find waxy interiors. You don't want that because you certainly don't want the bunny, you know, chewing on it. You certainly don't want it smelling like meat. Bunny's not gonna be very happy about that. But just, you can find these at a grocery store, you know, a variety of different places. And most of these places are giving them away free. So it makes a wonderful place for your bunny to chew on, hide on, dig on, you know, all of that sort of thing. You know, another kind of thing that you can find easily, I'm gonna show this right here. Okay, this one you can hide in, but you know, this is simply, you know, a concrete form for like making a concrete pylon. And again, Bunny loved the tunnels. So now you've got a tunnel this Bunny can run through. And you can end up, you know, they're inexpensive. They can, you know, run through there, hide in there. And I've taken them also and taped them together and put them behind my couch so they can run through the tunnel, but they can't get to like the wire cord behind my couch. They can't get under my couch from, you know, from behind there. But they have this wonderful tunnel, you know, to run through. So things like that, you know, make it really, really comfortable. Okay, we're gonna come back around here.
Joy, I have someone asking if you could touch on water bottles, why they're not good, and why you should use Crocs for water.
Okay, so I'm going to, let's see, grab this here really quickly.
Do you wanna just bring it to the table?
I will bring it to the table. Right. Good question, and it is part of the housing. And so, first of all, water bottles. No water bottles in nature. Nowhere, okay? Then rabbits suck water like a horse. They do not lap water like a dog or a cat. That makes this an abnormal motion, okay?
Talking about dogs, when you go to a pet store and you see one of these in for the puppies, and they're just licking also, that's horrible.
Okay, so I have on my, when I do talk to people about, you know, during orientation and they're adopting a bunny, I have a picture that, it's a cartoon, but it has a picture of a human and the water faucet with one drop of water coming out and the person, okay, sticking their tongue out, said, would you go to the faucet, turn it on a drip and stick your tongue under it? No, you want a glass of water, okay? So this poor bunny, you know, has got one stinking drop of water at a time. Now that might fill that hamster's mouth, gerbil, what have you, but it's a drop of water for a rabbit. They estimate that a 5-pound rabbit drinks as much water as a 20-pound dog, okay? This isn't gonna cut it. You know, then you've got this going on constantly because the rabbit never gets enough water to hydrate its body or quench its thirst, okay? So we suck water. You know, you wouldn't want to do this. And then if you don't do this exactly right, what happens?
They leak everywhere.
Yeah.
And the water all runs out.
Yes. What happens to the bottle when you don't clean it?
Green.
Slimy. Okay.
Nasty.
Yep. And one of our volunteers actually said they almost lost their first bunny because the ball got stuck. And they didn't realize it for 3 days. And then the bunny's limp and dehydrated. Well, then, you know, had to get to the vet's office, had to get sub-Q fluids. They managed to save it, but all because they didn't realize.
And I want to point out, most of our bunnies that come in are on the verge of dehydration because they don't get water.
Okay.
When we get them, they go through a bowl of water in hours. Or overnight, their water bowl will be empty. They're so thirsty.
First 3 days, we usually see them, you know. So, but we also do not want plastic bowls or the lightweight metal bowls because bunnies like toys. And if they can pick it up and toss it, it's a Frisbee, okay? And then they're gonna chew on it. We don't want this happening, okay? Because that's that plastic, you know, type of thing. So if we can get this, I'll hold this up, a nice heavy crockery bowl, okay? Full of water, okay? And if you've got, you know, like I've got one of our bunnies, education bunnies here, is 11 pounds. He's going to drink as much water as a 44-pound dog, okay? Now, crockery bowls at the pet store can be a little pricey for a big dog. You know what that is? It's a casserole dish, okay? So I was telling people, it could be, you know, Goodwill, it could be a garage sale, it could be Grandma's cupboard, she's not using it anymore, but it's got this nice, wide, flat bottom. The bunny cannot knock it over. So you don't want anything that is bowl-shaped because it's going to tip. And nothing that is glass, okay? Glass is can shatter, and now you've got these splinters and shards, and think about that bunny stepping on it and then trying to clean off his paw, dead rabbit again.
And the smaller bowl, if you look at your Dollar Trees, Dollar General, they usually have those for a dollar.
Sometimes. I haven't been able to see them lately.
Dollar General is starting to carry them for
good.
A dollar.
Okay. So there's, you know, and except it's a dog dish, you know. And if we can give our dog or cat fresh water every day, there is no excuse for not giving our bunny fresh water every single day.
Madison, you're welcome. I'm glad you asked the question about the water dishes and water bowls. We really want to get the word out. So you got the good information. Start spreading the word.
Yep. Very good things. Yeah. So other things that they, you know, need. Let me have that. Litter boxes. Okay. So, all right. We are using now a lot of these. These are just busboy tubs, okay? They're nice and deep. They're meant to be washed over and over and over again. They have handles. They're hard plastic, which makes it difficult for the bunnies to chew on them. And when that bunny jumps inside that litter box, lifts its tail, but stays inside the litter box, okay? And they're cheap, you know? So all of these things, that goes on really, really well. So now, unfortunately, a lot of the litter boxes are meant to be going into these little tiny cages. So, okay.
Well, they're actually, those.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So, yeah, you wanna grab Sedgwick for me?
Yeah.
Okay. So, now, take a look at this thing, okay, you know, and if you've got a little tiny bunny, so maybe you've got a Netherland dwarf, it might be able to find, you know, and you know this, but you know, like I said, you're bigger bunnies.
When you turn, when they jump in, and when they turn around to go to the bathroom, it's coming back out.
Right. And they can easily dig out, okay?
There's so not even enough room over. For litter in here. You'd have to change this twice a day.
Yes, okay. So, this is Sedgwick. He's one of our education bunnies, okay? And
come closer.
You think he's gonna, yeah. Think about him. Look at the back feet, okay? Even the back feet are gonna have a hard time fitting in there. You know, there's no way.
Not happening.
I always tell people, you know, think about this. You know, you got this corner. Do you give them a backup beeper? Beep, 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 beep. Because if they're not right on that corner, they're going to pee out over the edge, you know.
Plus, where do you put your hay?
Yes.
To get them to jump in to eat the hay, so, you know.
Yeah, for those people who put the hay, you know, like that, yes. Now, we have a lot of problems here in the mid-Midwest. We don't have a lot of really good, you know, timothy or grass hay. So we don't want to waste our hay because a lot of it we end up having to, you know, have brought in boxes from places who sell for the small animals in the hot boxes, which are a lot less expensive size-wise than the little, you know, bags, you know, at the pet store. So we end up making our own hay racks. Now, I'm going to grab that.
While she's grabbing that, Julie asked the question on what's best to wash your litter boxes with. We use white distilled vinegar. We tell everyone, go to Walmart or wherever and get a spray bottle for a dollar. Dump the vinegar straight in the bottle, completely straight. Soak your litter box with this and wipe it out. They'll never know you have a rabbit in your house unless they smell the hay.
White vinegar neutralizes rabbit urine.
This is the best thing to use for cleaning anything. Your carpet, if the bunny has a little dribble on the carpet, I soak it with this, dab it with a paper towel, it's gone.
It's like magic. Accident on the cage pad or something like that, spritz it with vinegar, toss it in the laundry, you know, like great. But do not dilute it with water. It has to be straight white vinegar.
That is, I forgot to mention that. If they pee on their blankets, the best stain remover ever. Soak it with this, like Joy said, throw it in your washer, it'll come out, you'll have nothing left on it. It's great.
And brand is not an issue. It doesn't matter, you can get the cheapest vinegar out there, just as long as it's white vinegar, okay? So going back to the hay racks, they need to eat their body size in hay every day. Well, you just saw Sedgwick, okay? So this isn't going to cut it, okay? Not to mention, you've got even a spot for the salt wheel, which we would never give them. The little tiny things like this. This is going to last like 2 seconds in a bunny's cage. It becomes a chew toy, and it doesn't have anywhere near enough hay. It's a little tiny amount of hay. This is going to just fall apart. Okay, little tiny amount of hay. So this is one of my favorites because it spins. It's really cute. It's got pictures of bunnies on it. How do they get to it? You give him a tweezers, there is absolutely no way for that bunny to get to it. We actually had a bunny come in. Well, we lost the bunny. He starved to death because this is what he had for, you know, for hay. So it's, you know, this is really cute, but it doesn't provide the amount of hay that they need. So there's a variety of things I've seen people, if you go on, the website, you know, not our website, but I mean, go on just internet and, you know, DIY items for, you know, for hay racks. We've seen a variety of them out there.
Oh yeah, there is a lot of creativity out there. Mm-hmm.
We make one so that we have it available for our members, you know, here. And, you know, so this is, you know, it's got long prongs so they can't knock it off. We hang it over the litter box. It has a lid and it opens up from the back, because if it opens up this way or doesn't have a lid, a lot of the bunnies like to sit in there, eat their hay, poop and pee in it. So now you've just ruined all the hay. We've adjusted it so it has openings so that the bunny, whether it's full or empty, the bunny can get to all of the hay, and it's a full amount, a full day's amount. And hay should be in front of them 24/7, okay? It's something they need to have, fiber in front of them 24/7. So we wanna make sure they have that. And again, this fits just nicely, you know, on the side of the cage or the side of the pen, right over the litter box. And that encourages the bunny to get in the litter box, fiber in, fiber out, you know, so if they really, you know, we have what they need for this, okay? Then, let's see.
One other thing, oh no, I just lost it, someone.
Question?
Oh, yes. We do sell the hay racks at our bunny shelter in our store, and we also sell hay. And Joy, you want to give them the hay breakdowns? They asked if we sell hay here at our shelter.
We do sell hay. I mean, we have actually variety. Four different places that provide hay, again, in boxes, and so that we can sell them in 5-pound, 10-pound, 20-pound boxes. Because again, the bunny's going to need to go through a lot of hay. So rather than getting that little, you know, bag, that way back when I started with bunnies, the first thing I noticed on the, because I almost didn't get my bunny hay, because on the side it said a high fiber treat. Mm-hmm. No. 80% of their diet is just like a horse. 80% of their diet
They're
should be
hay. They're selling a new hay, I think it was at Petco, that has all kinds of junk food in the hay.
In the hay?
That says a fiber treat.
No, okay.
The only thing fiber in it is the few strands of hay. Everything else is junk.
Well, I mean, dried carrots. Carrots have too much sugar in them. So you don't want a lot of, you know, and this is like giving your child a plate of dinner that has ice cream, cake, candies, you know, pie, you know. Where's their nutrition?
And I am one of those bunny moms, which some people think I'm too hard on my bunny, but if I see that he's not eating enough hay for the day, he don't get any treats, he gets half of the pellets that he normally will get, and then he knows he better step up eating the hay, and if he eats it before I go to bed, then I'll give him something special, but I'm very strict. If my bunny hasn't eaten two small hay racks of hay, he don't get anything extra. Because I want him eating the hay.
And we'll, you know, we'll do a different segment and show you some information on why, pictures of teeth and things like this, why it's really important for them to have the hay. You know.
I want to tell Sally thank you. She just donated to us.
Oh, thank you.
We really appreciate it.
Everything there goes to the bunnies. We are a 100% volunteer organization. Nobody gets a penny in salary. You have to want to be here to help the bunnies. Otherwise, you know, that's
it. We just get lots of bunny kisses.
We do, yeah, lots of that.
That's our thing. Another one says, my rabbit doesn't eat his size in hay. Am I feeding him too much pellets? Probably.
And some bunnies, you know, aren't necessarily going to eat their whole body size in hay, but they do need to have a sufficient amount. The other thing that occurs, or, you know, that I think about, is that if he's not eating a good amount of hay every day, is there a reason why? So it could be that he's getting too much other things. Could be that he's getting too many fresh greens. But it also could be that maybe the hay doesn't taste good to him. And how much food are you going to eat if it doesn't taste good to you?
Sometimes if you switch the brand of hay that you're feeding, mm-hmm. they may like it better. Or if you go to the softer hay like we do, The third cut is what my Benny loves. If you give him second cut, he won't eat it.
But, you know, again, second cut, and I
just tell people,
is better for your bunny. The stems, you know, those are one, the harsh material, that's what really, really helps them wear down those teeth. And it is a little, you know, has a little less protein and calories in it as well. So the only time I really recommend the third cut is if you have like severe hay allergies.
Which, hello.
Yeah, I know.
I've developed them.
Or, you know, you've got an older bunny that's having a harder time, you know, chewing. Or you've got a bunny that just flat out, you know, won't eat that. But as long as you don't have any hay allergies, I really do recommend, you know, the second cutting or even the first cutting. The first cutting is almost entirely stems and seed heads. And that bunny really gets a lot of good fiber from that. But there are bunnies that don't like the really crunchy stuff. So that's why the second cut is usually a little leafier, a little, you know, has little softer stems and things like that. So it has a little more flavor to it. And that's another reason why I really like, you know, the boxes, because the flavor or the smell, you really smell that. And when you open those boxes, it smells like you've just been out cutting your lawn.
It really does.
And that is what's attracting you. Think about you again, eating dinner. If it smells bad, are you going to eat it? You know, so.
If you live in our area, you're more than welcome to come to our shelter, and we would be more than happy to show you the different types of hay. Mm-hmm. And maybe you can take a little sample of them and see which one your bunny likes the best to help him eat more hay.
We've done that. We have orchard grass. We have, you know, the various cuts of Timothy. We have different brands because they come from different places around the country. And of course, unfortunately, hay is also a natural product. They're being cut every year. So you never know from year to year, too, exactly what you're going to get, because the growing season can be different. There can be different amounts of rain. It could be too hot, too dry, too rainy. All of these things, this is Mother Nature, and that can't be controlled. So, you know, you're just, you know, that's why we try to, you know, provide a variety. And we have bunnies, people who say, I like this, like that. And I say, think about yourself, you know, do you have a particular brand of, say, soda that you like? I mean, I know people, it's like, okay, they're both colas, but no, I only drink this one, you know. Bunnies can be the same way.
And I hear all the time people trying to switch the brand of hay, and their bunnies say, nope, not going to eat it. I don't care if you starve me. I'm not eating one strand of hay. So they have to go back to what they were feeding.
Yeah.
I have another question. How about fresh grass?
No.
We do get that a lot.
Yeah, a lot of that. You know, some people want to put their bunny out in the yard. And, you know, which, is, you know, you can get some fresh grass that way because at least it is fresh. But you're also, you have to make sure that you are really staying on top of your parasite medication, both external and internal. Because they can pick up, you know, coccidia, they can pick up, you know, hookworm, pinworm, they can pick up, you name it, they can pick up all kinds of, again, when we do the medical section, we're going to be going into this stuff.
Also, my neighbor was spraying...
pesticide?
Yeah, like a wet one.
Yeah.
Which I know that blows over into my yard, so I would never, ever
Fertilizer can do it too, you know, can kill them. So all of these things, you know, take into consideration. Now, if you were talking about, say, cutting the grass and bringing it in, grass becomes toxic within 24 hours, okay? The reason you use hay, and, you know, again, you can go into hay forever, but when they cut hay, they're supposed to cut it when there is a forecast of no rain for the next 3 to 5 days. It needs to lay out there in that field and sun dry. It is a cured product. While it is drying, it is also allowing the rodents and the insects to leave the field. Well, the rodents get out of there pretty quickly, but it takes a little while for all those insects to get out there. If they bale that hay too quickly, it can be wet on the inside, and it'll still be full of live bugs. It's going to mold. Mold will kill a horse, let alone a bunny.
Yep.
And it can spontaneously combust into flame because it's building up heat in there. So unless you are really, really, you know, familiar with the hay and all of that and cut it open or what have you, you know, the bales of hay, you know, around here, I'm very cautious about that. But as far as, you know, back to the problem is, it's a cured product. When they put that up in the loft, it's there for the next year for, say, to feed the horses or livestock, you know, type of thing. So it has to be an edible product for a full year, okay? So just a little segue off of that. Pelleted food is not a cured product. Once you open that bag, it's like stale in 30 days. And that's why I never recommend, like, you've got a, one or two bunnies, a 50-pound bag of food. Yeah, it might be cheap, but it's going to be stale in 30 days. And if you're only using a quarter cup of pelleted food a day, you're only going to go through about 5 pounds. So now you got 45 pounds worth of stale food or rancid food. And it's like, you don't be giving your bunny that. So the hay is, like I said, a cured product. You can get a 20-pound box of hay, and it's fine. Doesn't matter how long it takes your bunny to eat it because it's a cured product. It's still perfectly edible and safe.
One tip, though, is if I buy a bag, I guess about this big of food here from the shelter, but my bunny only gets an eighth of a cup, so I freeze it so it stays good and fresh and only take out like this much a week so it stays
in the
fresh.
Freezer, it will stay fresh for about 6 months.
Yep, so, that's all I do is one bag at a time.
Yep, and you know, so all of the, you know, those, you know, things. So going back, you know, to that housing, so now we've got, you know, the litter box, you know, we've got the hay rack, you've got the hay, the, you know, water bowl, the food bowl. I recommend a small food bowl because at just a quarter cup or an eighth of a cup, when you put that in there, and I really, really recommend using a measuring cup. Your hand, you can be way off base, okay? So measuring cup, and when you put that in there, it looks so pathetic that you're just tempted to put more in. Oh my gosh, there's not much in there. You want to put
more in?
Don't do
it. No,
but if you get a little dish, okay, it doesn't look so bad, okay? And don't let your bunny talk you into more because it really can be a major problem for them.
Yeah, I always say that we can love our bunny to death because we love them so much when they give us those cute little faces. You want to give them those extra treats and do all that, but it's really not good for them.
Yeah. So, you know, now going back to them, you know, being in their house, you know, for, you know, long periods of time, they get bored, okay? So we really want to make sure that, one, they have chew toys, okay? And there's a lot of things out there that you can find. One of the things, now we actually make this ourselves, so they can hang it in there and let's see, okay? So everything on there is edible. They can chew on all of this stuff. Makes a nice, you know, hanging in there so they can't pee on it either, so we hang it up. There's other kinds of things, plenty of things out there that we'll actually go into a little bit more, you know, later. We'll probably try to come up and show you like a toy every time we, go on air. But things that you can find, and there are places that really have some nice things. Let me hand one of that to me. This is another thing we make for the bunnies. So this is a wooden chew toy. And they can chew on this just
100%
fine.
100% edible.
Everything that, you know, on here. You know, for hiding box or if you want like the activity benches, you know, types of things, we make those too, okay? Nice big ones. Everything's edible again. And they can, plenty of room for even a big bunny to sit on top of. And then the, you know, but for tossing around and things like that, oh my gosh, you know, I mean, there's things that we make as well, but think about, so there's some really easy things that you can find, sometimes even at the garage sale. So I tell people they like to make noise, okay? So hard plastic rattles, okay? Hard plastic teething rings, okay? Here's another hard plastic teething ring, you know? Hard plastic balls, okay? This is just a nice wiffle ball, okay? Hard plastic slinkies, they love these things, okay? And you can find them, you know, all kinds of places. Here's some hard plastic teething rings. Okay,
those,
they love those,
are one of the favorites, and mine carries it around in his mouth.
Oh yeah, sometimes they carry their toy with them.
Yeah,
and they love to make noise. So you know, you make sure that they're not necessarily in the bedroom with you when you've got this, because they do not necessarily make quiet evening companions. It gets actually pretty noisy around here. But things, because we don't have dogs and cats, that it's quiet in here. I'm like, oh no, we got this going on all night long, okay? Because they're playing. And then
they are noisy when they get to be playing.
But you can find these all over the place. You've got friends that have toddlers, or they're getting rid of their baby toys or their toddler
yard
toys.
Yard sales, Goodwill, Dollar Tree.
Yeah.
Surprisingly has
some of those.
Good for a dollar.
You know, it's a wiffle ball. You know. Yeah. All these things that you can find. You know, you can find some hard plastic cat ones too. So it's just a variety of things that you can end up doing just to, so that your bunny has fun. And, while they are, in that house. We just want to make sure that, you know, that they have, like I said, things. One of the things, in fact, if you go on our website, you probably have to scroll down or look for it, but one of our members, you know, got one of these, like, these Einstein-type, you know, dog toys, you know, where they have to figure out where the treats are and everything. Mm-hmm. And honestly, I really think the bunnies figure them out twice as fast as the dogs do.
I agree.
Yeah. And I mean, this one even had a lever that the bunny had to flip the lever.
She tried two different kinds, and he figured them out that quick.
Yes. Yeah.
And it is posted on our Facebook. If you scroll down a little bit, you will see a very large bunny with long ears. That's the video you want to watch.
Yeah, she's got them, I think, on there, you know, two or three places.
We do have another question.
Okay.
Dandelions, outside dandelions, is that okay to feed your bunny?
If you wash them very well, because they could have parasite eggs on them. You know, again, toxics, you know, if somebody's, you know, sprayed any kind of pesticide or fertilizer type of thing on there. So as long as you are washing them really well and you know that ground has not been sprayed, because again, it's going to suck up the pesticide inside. That's why it dies, because it sucks up everything inside. And then, so if you're washing it, you can, but again, anything that's in there more than 24 hours, it's toxic, okay? It's dying. And so you need to get it completely out of that rabbit's cage. There are places that actually sell dandelion
leaves.
They do.
Yeah. Fresh Thyme.
Mm-hmm.
I think even Walmart does now. They sell fresh. Yeah, I'm pretty sure Walmart does. But going back to me being a very strict bunny mom is, I don't give mine that type of variety of stuff because I had a bunny that was very tummy sensitive. Mm-hmm. And I went through the yucky poop on the butt, lots of vet visits. So I now am very picky, and I don't give a variety of stuff. I do the basics,
mm-hmm.
and I do greens, but I stick with the same four greens, and I don't have any problems.
Yeah. The one thing about greens is that you need to introduce them one at a time to your bunny, because again, you don't know what that bunny's tummy is like. So, and stick with that green for maybe 3 or 4 days, okay? So now you know your bunny's tummy is okay handling that particular green. When it comes to, so then you wanna go to the next green. And again, start out with a little bit because you don't know if your bunny's gonna be sensitive to it or not. And then the next day you could give maybe a little bit more. So instead of handing like an entire bunch of parsley, you know, you maybe the first day they only get one sprig. And maybe the next day they get 3 sprigs, and maybe, you know, the third day, you know, 4 or 5 sprigs. And but even at any given point in time, we really recommend just a handful of dark leafy greens, because if they get too many leafy greens, they will ignore their hay, and the hay is really critical for their gut and for their teeth.
Again, if mine doesn't eat his hay,
there you go.
I don't give him his greens at night, and he knows.
Although I will throw this tip out there, if your bunny is in a heavy shed, I do have a tendency to give them a little more really wet greens
because
I want lots of fiber going through.
Yeah.
And again, you need to be brushing them. So we'll go. That'll be another topic for, you know, for a different time. But you know, that is one time when I, you know, maybe give them, you know, a little bit more.
Yeah, my grandson came out today and said, "Grandma, baby Frankie's shedding really bad. We need to brush him."
Yeah.
So I hand him the brush and they go brush him. Very good.
So like I said, we've got a whole list of topics that we're going to come up with. But if you have a particular topic that you would really like us to talk to, go ahead and put that on, you know, the right now.
Yes.
So that we can see the things that you're interested in learning about.
And that's what we're here for. And what we're trying to do
is
to help you guys have a happy bunny in your home, because a happy bunny is happy parents. And that's what we're here for.
Yeah,
one more
for sure.
Is Catherine's bunny says, or she, it loves wicker and willow things and destroys them really fast. We recommend them. And we have a ton of different variety of toys like that here. Clovers. What about clovers?
Okay. Clover, again, is, you know, has a little bit too much, you know, protein in it. So a little bit, again, if you're washing it really, really well, you know, to make sure that your bunny's not picking up, you know, anything, you know, and again, you have to know that there was no spray, no pesticide, no fertilizer, you know, type of thing there. And then again, just keep it really, really washed, and just a little bit, because, you know, it's interestingly enough, when I have put a lot of clover out, or I see, you know, clover. The wild bunnies don't eat that much clover. Yeah. So, you know, it's not as much as you might think that they would like, you know.
And honestly, there's so many good things out there for bunnies right now.
Oh, yeah.
I wouldn't waste my time on the stuff growing in your yard.
No.
Get them the safe stuff that you know they're going to love.
Yeah. Yeah. Because the only time.
And be safe.
You know, and I started out doing wildlife rehab. I had to go out and harvest things that these wild bunnies were going to be eating, because this is what they were going to be going out to have. Mm-hmm. And even at doing that, I washed them. I made sure that they were out, because when that bunny's eating them, they're eating them fresh, you know, not 24 hours later.
Yep.
So, yeah, so when it's becoming, you know, starting to decay. So we want to just be really, really careful with a lot of that stuff. And there's, like I said, too much good produce out there.
Yeah, there's
easy
just
to
too
get.
Many good things out yeah. there. Does pineapple help with hair caught in the bunny's throat or stomach, especially when a female is nesting?
Okay, if a female is nesting, she needs to be spayed, one thing, and that's a whole different conversation. But when they're nesting, they are actually spitting out the hay. They're not ingesting the hay. They're plucking it out of their body so they can make a nest, and they are spitting it back out. They're not eating it. And of course, if that bunny's not fixed, it can also be false pregnancies, you know.
Which we have gotten some of those.
We have had that as well. But again, they're spitting, you know, that hay out. But pineapple and papaya is another thing, you know, that sometimes people think about, is very, very high in sugar. Sugar causes an enteritis or an inflammation of the gut, you know, too much of that. So you could end up killing your bunny by giving them too much pineapple or, you know, any kind of high, you know, sugar mm-hmm. type of thing. And it really does not break down hair, okay?
No.
The only thing that breaks down hair in it is like Drano. You want to kill your bunny? Yeah, obviously, you know, we're not
right.
giving the bunny Drano.
The best thing to do is brush, mm-hmm. brush, and brush your bunny more.
Heavy hay, it's that heavy browse that pushes that hair through the other way, okay?
Yep.
And not the pineapple juice. That doesn't, you know, so the only thing that is, has a possibility of doing is the enzymes. Hair, it's not so much a hairball. It's the food and everything is all gunked to the hair. So, you know, sometimes a little bit of that, you know, digestive aid can maybe help break up the food, which might let the hair then separate and go on through the body. But how's it going to get through? More fiber, okay?
That's why not 80% that. Of the diet should
right.
be hay.
Right.
We have one that says, what about cilantro, parsley, and spring mix?
Okay.
Which, all those are good.
All those are good. The only thing that I tell people this just as a cautionary thing. I have a tendency to not really use romaine anymore.
I don't.
And that's simply because we've had a lot of recalls on romaine. And when it does have a problem and they do a recall on it, it's usually because it's got salmonella poisoning in it, okay? Bacteria. And salmonella is extremely, extremely toxic for a rabbit. They're going to get sick and die far sooner than you will be sick. So by the time they're doing a recall because people are sick, that bunny's dead, okay? So, and you, since you don't know, you know.
Yeah, it's
yeah.
it just happens too much that I don't give.
Right.
I don't
yeah,
give it either.
I stick with more of the green leaf, red leaf.
And yeah. she asked how much, which... A handful.
Again, a handful of dark leafy greens.
Yep.
Doesn't matter what kind it is. If you chopped it up, it amounts to about 2 cups, you know, worth of greens. But literally, yeah, it's just a handful so that they're not getting too much and ignore their hay.
And Madison wanted you to know that she's going to college for wildlife conservation.
2 thumbs up. Okay.
Yes, I think that's great. Oh my goodness. I can't see this one. This is so funny. I can't get it up. Which 4 greens do you stick with?
Okay. We stick with probably with a little bit, you know, different. But like I said, I like the green leaf. I like the red leaf. I do kale. I like kale. And, you know, and some, I usually use the Italian parsley, but, you know.
Yeah, I do Italian parsley, red leaf and green leaf, and that's what I stick with.
Yeah. Bunnies really, really love kale, and it's just, again, as long as you're not overdoing it, everything's fine.
And I think if you just give it as a special treat once or twice a week.
And the nice thing about grains, too, is that this is a great thing. You know, if you have children, they get home from school or something like that, instead of letting them give the bunny a treat, give them a piece of greens. The bunny loves it. Okay?
Guilty.
A piece of, yeah.
Mind
piece of
you, parsley. Yeah. One little parsley at a time.
Yeah.
They love it.
Yeah, and it's fun watching the bunny eat that piece of parsley. Like
my grandkids
spaghetti.
Love it.
Yes. Okay.
Strawberries.
Strawberries. A slice of strawberry. Actually, the best thing to do is take and slice the top of the strawberry off. You get a little bit of strawberry and that nice little green leaves on top.
Best thing for them.
Yeah.
How do you medicate a bunny for a future topic?
Future topic.
That is a great.
Yeah.
Great.
Definitely,
great
we can do that.
What was this one for another future topic? Is any time outside okay for bunnies?
Okay, there are varying opinions on this.
Do you want the good cop or the bad cop opinion?
And yeah, because I'm kind of the bad cop opinion on this.
Oh,
because
me
we
too.
Have so many predators around here that, you know, I'm actually thinking that that might be actually a good topic for a separate time because we really would have to get into it. And I know you wanted to take a few minutes to do it. Didn't you want to just talk about the young adult? And
yes.
Okay.
Yes. So if I haven't answered your question, I will come on later and finish answering them. But since time is running
short,
we are going to do from 7 before our Joy and mine, our little talk show, from 7:15 to 7:30. Two of our volunteers, young volunteers, Gabby and Michael, are going to do a 15-minute segment on teaching people, not really teaching, but
no,
just...
but answering questions,
yeah.
Too. Like the young lady who is going to school, you know, for,
right.
Well, for conservation.
So they can tell you what they're doing going to just well, regular school.
School
now, going off to college, what they do with
right.
Your bunny, getting married, having your first baby. You know, usually all this is...
And not getting rid of your bunny.
Correct.
Okay.
This
how
is
do
usually,
I cope?
Yeah. This usually all happens, you know,
right.
Mid-teens, late 20s. And these two are going to be here to answer all your questions and just talk things through and tell you what they're doing and how they're making it work. So,
right.
And they might have little guests come on from volunteers that are within that age group that can share some of their stories.
Right. Yeah.
So tune in next week for that. Bob will be here next Tuesday.
He said it was because of a late rescue, had to go out, loose bunnies, and they was not close to here. We, around this area, the animal controls will not go out and catch a stray rabbit, and they really don't want any part of them. We end up getting the phone calls, and we have our volunteers who have a very strict protocol on how they can handle this sort of thing, which, again, we're not going to go into this week. But unfortunately, like I said, late rescue, and were we going to tell them? No, because that bunny's life is in jeopardy, you know, when they're out there loose.
Correct. And Bob is our guy, and I know most all of you know who Bob is. Once you see him... You're going to be so happy to put a face with all his posts that he does on all the rabbit websites he
right.
goes on. But Bob is, he's the guy. If Bob can't catch the bunny.
That's true.
Nobody's going to catch the
yeah.
bunny.
Yeah.
So please tune in next week because we're going to have Bob and Jeannie come in and they're going to share their rescue stories. Where some of the bunnies, you know, how they caught them, how horrible it's been. And then, of course, you're going to want to meet Michael and Gabby and hear their fun stuff. So
right.
tune in next week. I'm going to put two different events on, one for Michael and Gabby and then one for mine and Joyce. So you can have two different links to click on. So I think that's everything.
I think so.
Thanks for joining us.
Yeah.
We love having you.
Just check when we can make sure there's no other questions. Oh, and if you're local... we are having our bunny experience. It's on our website. It's on our Facebook page. It's on our Instagram. And so it's because we talked last week about don't going out and getting a baby bunny, you know, for Easter or for springtime, you know, type of thing. Yes, they are so cute, but that's a 10 to 12 year commitment, you know. And so we opted to have what we're calling a bunny experience. And, you know, so we can have families in here. We're doing this in a very COVID-safe manner, that they can have, get a photo with a bunny, they can pet a bunny, they can make a bunny toy, give it to one of our foster bunnies, and, you know, and then we have a little treat bag for them, you know, for the child, not for the, you know. And it's, and it was
unless
really interesting.
Unless the child wants to share.
Yeah, that's it's fine. But we even actually have, you know, an adult signed up who said, I don't have any children. I would just like to come in and see the bunnies and pet a bunny. Like, that's fine.
Yeah,
okay,
we're fine. Everybody come in.
But like I said, we're doing it by appointment segments so that we can keep everybody, you know,
safe.
You know, safe and do that separation, you know, space-wise and all of that sort of thing. So, yeah, so if you're interested, and like I said, you're local, get on, you know, I said, on our website, because that's, you go to our store on our website, that's where you can purchase your time slot. And it's about a roughly an hour long, you know, for your experience.
And you get to meet all these great people that you're seeing here.
Yeah.
So come and meet us.
Lots of bunnies.
And see that big bunny that we showed you earlier.
Oh, yeah.
He's going to be in the room that you get to come visit.
Yes.
So you're not going to want to miss seeing him.
Yeah.
Right?
Yep.
We're good.
Absolutely.
So we will see you guys next Tuesday.
Bye.